Thank you. I came from Helena to get away from the juke joints, and when I came over here, I wasn't sure what I was getting into. And I saw this place, and it was closed. And my boss says, well, they're not open yet. I said, that's where we're going? I thought it was going to be some little grocery store, a little hamburger joint or something. Was I ever surprised? What a beautiful place and a wonderful audience. And run into half of Helena over here. I don't know if I'm following them or they're following me. There's one gentleman, where'd he go? Mark and I worked together a long time ago with John Weston and a whole lot of others, and Jeffrey Lou Ellen told me, he says, you know, I did what you're doing tonight, and I wish to God he'd do it tonight. I'm not good at audience participation here. I will tell you shortly, and I've done this. I started in 1941, and then I went in the Army in 1942, came back in 51, and then I went on the road as a musician for a while, and then I came back. Been back almost 61 years now, and I have so many things that I've... They were talking about Elvis Costello. Well, I have one gentleman. He came in here one day. We do this show down at the Delta Cultural Center in downtown Helena. And this big fella came in with his little boy. And I didn't ask his name. And I said, look around the museum. And our show starts at 12:15. Never did ask his name. He came and sat down in a minute, and I said, come on back here with me. It was on a Monday, and nobody's there on Monday. They're closed, but we still do the show there. And I was really embarrassed. I interviewed him maybe 10 minutes, and I said, I never did ask your name. The show was almost over. I did interview him. I said, where are you from? He said, the UK, United Kingdom. I said, what do you do over there? Well, I play a little golf and do a little singing. Good. And the little boy spoke up and said, Daddy plays too. I don't know what he meant by that. He didn't play an instrument to my knowledge, but Zeppelin and all of them over in the UK I knew about, but I didn't connect this dude. We have a telephone in the control room there, and I said, well, that'll do it for today. I didn't catch your name. What was it? And he said, Robert Plant. Here's where the embarrassment came in. I said, who the hell is Robert Plant? What are you going to do in a case like that? I knew about Zeppelin. I knew those boys, but I'd forgotten about him. They had broken up, you know, and I hadn't seen him in a while. And never met him before. And he's been back on the show twice. Last year, last August, he came to Clarksdale, Mississippi for their festival. And when he did, I called a friend of mine, Cathead Records over there in Clarksdale, and I told him, I said, tell Robert to cancel his engagement. Now, dig this. The day he came in, I'd gone to London. Tell him to come over and interview me in London or be on the show over there. I went over to see some friends, and when I came back, he had a little note. He didn't leave it with me. He left it with this friend of mine and said, tell Sonny I'll see him next year, but this time I'm going to charge him. And he would, too. He did a little tour group with Ellison, some Nashville girls. She's good, I hear. I've never met the young lady, but I heard she's really fabulous. I thought we had Garth Brooks up here, that big tall dude with the hat on. I thought that was him, really. Okay. Being in this business is so much fun. You meet so many people, and they all have stories to tell, and you really don't have time to hear them all. A lot of people have no earthly idea what blues is. I don't like to get into that too much because it's a long, drawn-out thing, but I'll give you a short version of it. You can ask 30 people about blues, and you'll get 30 different answers. There are a lot of people that know more about it than I do, and all these years I've been in it, I learned something new almost every week from some of the musicians. But nevertheless, Sonny Boy was promised $3,000, Sonny Boy Williamson, to go to London at Crawdaddy's Club, still over there to the club. And the guy promised him $5,000, and he took with him Matt Murphy and Memphis Slim and a bunch of others. And when he got back from the tour, they loved him so much over there, they really did. They paid for he could even buy his food. Every time he got through, they saw him in the hotel room, in the lobby, or at breakfast, they bought his food. One guy said, "I saw you in your club last night." He went into this tailor next door and bought a suit. The guy made a suit for him, this is a true story, and a derby. The suit is half gray on one side, with the sleeves and legs, true. We got the picture down there at the museum. And half black on this side. And he gave him a derby, and he said, "How much I owe you?" He said, "You don't owe me a thing. I loved your show." This is what I'm getting up to. He didn't spend any money, hardly. $10 at the most. He got back to New York, and the guy says, "Sonny, you did great. Here's your check." This is before desegregation now, and this leads up to what I'm saying. He says, "Well, $3,000. You promised me $5,000. But he didn't tell the guy that, and he said, "Am I reading that wrong?" He said, "No, $3,000. Now, what did I just tell you a moment ago?" He said, "Well, Sonny Boy, you had a lot of expense. You know, you drink a lot," and he did. "And you spent a lot of money over there." What did I just tell you? Matt Murphy, Memphis Slim, said he didn't spend $10 the whole damn time he was over there. Sonny Boy couldn't say what he wanted to at that point in time. If he had, it'd have been dead. You know that, before desegregation. He couldn't do it. Nobody talked to him. So he said, "Well, I appreciate you much." And he said, "Where are you going now?" And he said, "I'm going home to Glendora, Mississippi, and back to Helen, Arkansas. I still had a band there." And he said, "But I'm making a song, an LP, for the Chess Brothers label out in Chicago, Illinois. I'm not ignoring you folks. I'm not used to side widening." But nevertheless, he said, "I'm going to dedicate a song to you." He made the LP and sent it to New York. And the guys looked at the LP. It's called "I Ain't Fattening No More Frogs for Snakes." Really? That's a real song. He didn't write it, Elmore James, I think, wrote it. And nevertheless, you know what that means in the South, frog gigging. Water moccasins love those snakes, those frogs. They love them. That was his way of calling him a name. Now, this man that was working for him, his agent says, Do you know what he just did? He called you a snake. Now, the guy that told him that was from Alabama. And he said, what are you talking about? He said, well, he's calling you a dirty name. I'll reiterate one quick thing. Blues musicians and artists, a real McCoy, they can call you every name in the book or make fun of you in a song. You'd never know it. So that's what he did. He couldn't say what he wanted to at that point in time. He screwed him out of his money, and he says, here's your song. I ain't fat no more frogs or snakes. And the guy from Alabama says, you don't understand. He said, all I know is you dedicated that to me. Isn't that wonderful? Crazy. Really. Thank you. Sonny Boy Williamson was one of the all-time greats. You have some greats. One of them from over here in Little Rock, Michael Burks. How about that? Michael Burks was, you hear a lot of them come, hey, can I be on your show? I do the blues. There's one thing you have to realize, you have to live the damn blues before you sing it. No, I'm serious. That's where your blues comes in. This is what I've been telling you. Sonny Boy lived it. That was one of his experiences. But it's also derived from gospel, Afro-American gospel music, too, as well. You got the best of both worlds in that feel. And anyway, what I started to say, Sonny Boy lived on a farm in Glendora, Mississippi, and his father worked in his gin mill, gin and cotton. I don't want to get carried away. I only have a short time. She's giving me a dirty look over there. But anyway, when my daughter was living, she lived up north, and she came south to see me. And she'd never been south. And I took her back to the airport, and I always like beef eaters martinis. I love them. And they're made out of gin, not vodka. On the way back to the airport, she saw the sign in Tunica, Mississippi. It said Tunica Gin. She said, Dad, you ever try that Tunica Gin? Nope. She had no earthly idea of what that was. So I drove around off of the old 61 highway, and I showed her a gin mill where they gin cotton. Oh. You mean they waste all that gin? Cleaning cotton? This little girl was born and raised up north, and she had no earthly idea about the South. But getting back to Sonny Boy, this always gasped me a little bit. His father worked in this gin mill, a cotton gin, and we'll put it that way. And he stayed home with his mother and ran errands, played his music. And one day his father, it was in the hot summertime, like 110, in the shade. And he says, his mother came out on the porch and said, would you mind going down to they had to get the water out of the spring down below the house there. Fill this bucket of water, clean the dipper while you're out of there, and your father will be home for lunch. And he's going to want that water. He's hot and thirsty. And he came running back. He saw a big old alligator down there. He was scared him to death. He came back and he says, Mama, where's the water? He said, Mama, there's a big alligator down there. She said, Sonny Boy, your father's going to be home. That alligator ain't going to bother you. Go on back down there and get the water. He said, that alligator's afraid of you. He's afraid of everybody. Sonny said, Mama, If that alligator is scared of me as I is of him, that water ain't fit to drink in the first place. There's so much in the blues history that I cherish so much. I've been blessed. I've been lucky. I've been blessed. So many wonderful people I meet. Some of them are here tonight, all the way from Helen. Laura's heart grows. She didn't like Helen, so she moved over here. And Joe Griffith and my little niece over there, she owns a liquor store and still makes me pay for it. That's bad. That's bad. As I was saying, there's so many good things to in the blues field. Let me tell you something about blues. It's the greatest culture in the world. And some people abuse it, but for the most part, I said for the most part, Michael Burks, I want to reiterate about Michael. He was the closest thing. I've been doing this show 61 years, 60 whatever. He's the closest thing, gentleman, to really come up with the blues that I've ever heard in my life. And we're proud of Michael Burks. And he had a heart as big as he was. He was a big, pretty good-sized boy. And he loved him. I loved him dearly. And as I say, I've been blessed. And ladies and gentlemen, that's the name of that tune. Thank you so much. You're welcome. Come on, Shorty.